To look at many of our urban centers today is to look at how badly we've neglected the importance of urban planning. In Season 8 of Daya, we visit the old urban centers of Luzon to see how our ancestors maintained a sense of order. One that created spaces for communities, their economic and cultural activities, their daily lives. Indeed, the entire fabric of a solid, united community. This is Season 8 of Daya. Halina't dumayo, doon po sa amin. So much of Manila remains rooted in the old, just as it struggles tenaciously to survive the problems of urbanization. The law of the Indies may have dictated the layouts of urban centers, but it is a combination, time, human nature, and history that break the laws, so to speak. In the second episode of our season, scholars and historians take us on a tour of sites outside of Intramuros. It is through their eyes and voices that we discover the landmarks and urban centers beyond the walls of Intramuros. Ghetto for the Chinese. That was what the Parian was, the original vision of the Spanish colonizers for the urban center we now know today as Binondo. I wonder if they would have foreseen the huge impact that this ghetto would have on the economy and cultural life of Manila and the entire country. The one thing that most fascinates me about Binondo is the way that Chinese traditional culture still manifests so strongly in the streets and in public spaces.
Ginagawa namin to every year dito sa lugar na to, sa Binondo, Chinatown. Every year, sa location na to, yung pumihandaan ng mga ini-invite ng mga officer sa mga association. Most of them, puro Pilipino na. May halo lang mga half Chinese, may mga pure Chinese. Perform kami ng mga teatro act tungkol sa mga istorya ng mga santo nung araw, buhay-buhay ng santo. Yun ang pinapalas, parang opera.
And I often ask myself how, through the years, have these traditional Chinese forms become Filipino? This program is You can be happy or sad about it, but much of our contemporary culture is centered on the malls. Well, imagine the very first major mall of Manila, a whole street where luxury goods, business and service centers, churches and offices nestled together, a hub even before the word was popular, that showcased the affluence and power of Manila in the turn of the century. This was Escolta.
Escolta was an old street in Manila, which was near the Binondo area. So since it was near the Binondo area, Escolta became like a hub of business during the time of the Spaniards and also subsequently during the time of the Americans. Some of the major companies eventually went to Escolta, that it became the Ayala triangle of its time. And what happened was, you will also see the development of Manila as a city in what eventually happened to Escolta. So when the Americans came also, business continued to boom in Escolta. And you know, during the time when entertainment like television was new in the Philippines, Escolta was one of the places where the TV stations were. But eventually, because of urbanization, you needed more spaces for offices, which Escolta cannot give anymore because, again, the people were becoming too many. And Escolta lacked one facility that eventually became its demise, and that is the lack of parking spaces.
Today, young artisans and entrepreneurs are adding a new layer to Escolta's history. Their efforts at creating collectives for handmade artisanal products may yet define Escolta's reinvention, this time as a hub for independent artists, designers, and craftsmen.
Escolta would be a place to go because it's now having a renaissance, and a lot of people are redeveloping the buildings there as adaptive reuse. And a number of millennials have also set up shop with creative offices and co-sharing spaces in Escolta.
It is through the eyes and sensibilities of modern Filipinos that we extend the lives of our historic sites beyond the realm of nostalgia. And through the eyes of scholars that we may once again see the importance of many Manila landmarks that we have taken for granted or that we know nothing about.
Art Deco is a very important design heritage because this style epitomized modernity in a certain period in our country's history, which was the 1920s up until the 1940s. So that was the period between the U.S. colonial period, followed by the Commonwealth Republic, as well as the post-war period. And it's also the time when we had buildings which were designed largely by local architects. So prior to that, buildings were designed by priests or by foreign architects. This time it was designed by Western educated Filipino architects, the likes of which included Pablo Antonio, Juan Nakpil, Tomas Mapua, and a lot of these names eventually became national artists. you have buildings like the Far Eastern University, which still function as an academic facility. In fact, FEU is the biggest Art Deco school campus in the country. The first five buildings of the Far Eastern University campus was built by architect Pablo Antonio. Among the five, the oldest one would be the Nicanor Reyes Hall, or the main building, which was built in 1939. It's a very massive structure, which kind of looks like a giant machine. Supposed to be, it was inspired by the machinery of a cruise ship that was seen by the founder of the school and Pablo Antonio in one of his trips abroad. So it has a lot of bold geometric details to it. The massive columns, the lines, and it's still very much used by the Far Eastern University community as the main building of their school. Have the Metropolitan Theater, which is totally in the Art Deco style, but features a lot of local motifs like mangoes, like bananas, like capiz shells. Now, buildings or design which showed a lot about local cultural nuances. There's a need to preserve this kind of architecture because it showcases a particular style that was very popular in our history. And it shows us that we knew how to build. We knew how to build modern. We knew how to express ourselves. We knew how to make things suited for us. Because Art Deco was a very Western style architecture, but a lot of the local architects tweaked it to local sensibilities, giving it a very Filipino touch that made this style of Art Deco very uniquely ours.
Professor Shao Chua loves Manila in all its grit and grime. Here he ticks off the landmarks and public spaces that further our understanding of the city and its history.
Paco Park is probably one of the most romantic places in Manila. But it was a cemetery. It was a cemetery for the people who died during the cholera epidemic of the early 1800s. But you know, by the 1890s, this cholera cemetery was not anymore being used. It was basically an old, used up place. This is where they place Jose Rizal's body because nobody would expect that he would be buried there. But they buried him there. And that's why the first grave of Jose Rizal was there in Paco Park. The the old Ayala Bridge, this the present bridge was made of steel, and of course this was what it was like during the time of the Americans, and it was reconstructed after the war. There is an island in that bridge, which was an old orphanage. It's called Hospicio de San Jose. Puerta Isabel II, of course we know Intramuros was an ancient walled city that they started building in the 1590s. But even as late as the 19th century, they were adding, you know, features in the walls. They demolished some part of the wall and created the Puerta Isabel II, which is at the back of Intramuros, so that you can easily just pass by Binondo, straight from Intramuros to Binondo, through the Jones Bridge, Puente de España. Basically, the Carriedo Fountains was a fountain, and a very elaborate one with all those designs, made in honor of a governor general named Carriedo. And Carriedo, in the 1700s, was actually the one who instituted, he donated money so that there could be a water system in Manila. Carriedo did not live to see his water work completed. And in 1882, they constructed a fountain in honor of him near the Legarda area in Sampaloc. Pahawalang Legarda is a very old school building. It's the oldest school building in Manila. Pahawalang Legarda was built in 1922. With the land that was donated by Benito Legarda, by the family of Benito Legarda, who is one of our congressmen during the Malolos Congress, First Philippine Republic. It was designed by the son of Juan Luna, architect Andres Luna de San Pedro. This is one place where you would see the American contribution to education.
Looking through the list that Shaw was lovingly put together, I see a park, a bridge, a gate, a school, and fountain. All elements that make for a beautiful urban center. But beyond the nostalgic charm, the bigger concern is this: how do we preserve and how do we continue to grow? amount of Manila nostalgia can ever sanitize the harsh realities of what the modern city has become. Now more than ever, urban planning and conscientious preservation of the little that remains of our built heritage are issues that concern us all.
The conservation of Art Deco buildings is a mixed bag because there are Art Deco buildings which have been torn down. For example, most of the theaters which were built during that period in the districts of Santa Cruz and Quiapo in Manila have practically been torn down. You have houses and commercial structures which have also been torn down, as well as apartment blocks. There are good news, however, no? Because some buildings have been conserved, like the Rizal Memorial Sports Complex is still a sports complex. And you have apartments that are still lived in Malate, like Sikiya apartments.
Historic or heritage conservation has been fighting an uphill battle to make sure that we do not demolish all of these heritage structures. There is a law requiring permission from the three cultural agencies before you can demolish anything more than 50 years old. Now, the conservation of heritage structures is not just for culture and aesthetics. It's not just for memory and the love of things of the past, but in fact, conservation of these structures and the road and the urban networks around them, most especially the open spaces, are good environmental practice. The ideal thing to do from now on is first to survey what we have left, to conserve those spaces and buildings we know are still there, and to look for more opportunities for parks and plazas, because you need to balance the built environment or the structures and the tall skyscrapers that we build with open spaces, not just because it looks good, but also because it provides a place of opportunity for recreation for all of these people crammed in all of those buildings.
National artist for literature Nick Joaquin lovingly called Manila the city of his affectations. The popular band Hot Dog immortalized a sentiment that we who live here all feel. We want to keep coming home to Manila. We want to be able to be proud of this city, both its ancient history as well as its future. In the coming episodes of this season, we will be visiting heritage towns outside of Manila that are facing the very same problems the city does. Their ways of preserving and coping with the problems of urbanization will be future sources of Dayaw, our knowledge, our pride.